Very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you back to the series of webinars that McGraw Hill has organized in association with ClearIS. This is the last and the fifth webinar that we have. However, there are a few things I wish to clarify to you all before we proceed further. That, you know, though the webinar series comes to an end today, we will be having another webinar series after the preliminary exam next year. And that will be prior to the mains examination. In the meantime, I will be active on my Telegram channel where you can connect with me, where we will be putting up questions and answers for practice and all. On top of that, the McGraw Hill portal, the student portal, which is available exclusively for the readers of the third edition of the book, have been given certain study material there. And on top of that, at the McGraw Hill student portal, starting from the month of January, we will also be having certain video sessions where I will be putting up certain videos with respect to international relations. So as a result of which, those videos are also likely to help you in your overall preparation. So please make sure that you register your accounts on the student portal of McGraw Hill, which will be available. For the details, you can refer to, you know, the back cover of the book of the third edition, where there is a scratch card feature given. Apart from that, I am always available on my email address. And you can always contact me post these webinar series in case you have any doubts while you are studying the international relations. So anyway, without wasting much time, let's get going to the webinar. The topic for today is the challenges to the global nuclear proliferation order and India's nuclear program. Now you see, after India became independent, India decided to create an architecture. And that architecture was basically to facilitate the development and use of nuclear technologies in India. And in 1948, the Atomic Energy Commission was created as a body. The Atomic Energy Commission, which was created as a body, was also given the task by the Union government in 1948 itself to prepare a blueprint for nuclear technologies. So the Union government at that time told the Atomic Energy Commission that please prepare a blueprint and identify that how India can take advantage of peaceful use of nuclear technologies and what are the sectors where India can actually try to use the nuclear technologies for civilian and peaceful use. Now, in 1951, the US government passed a very important law. Now, that law that the US government passed was basically the Mutual Defense Assistance Act. Now, under this Mutual Defense Assistance Act of the US, the government of United States basically decided to provide assistance to countries which are non-communist and to countries which are non-aligned with basically civilian nuclear support. You see, in the webinar number one, when we were basically discussing the terms and concepts, at that time I had told you one very basic thing, that the nuclear technology can be put to use for civilian purpose as well as military purpose. The civilian purpose of use of nuclear technology depends upon the percentage of enrichment of uranium. When you enrich uranium up to 3% to 5%, it is basically uranium which is used for nuclear energy generation. When you enrich uranium up to 20%, it is basically called uranium enriched for medicine purpose. And when you enrich uranium up to 90%, it is called military grade uranium. That military grade uranium is used for nuclear bomb. Now, two categories or two percentages that constitute the civilian category include basically the 3 to 5% which is for energy and 20% which is for nuclear medicine. So in 1951, what did the United States say? The United States at that time said that we are going to provide assistance to countries to develop technologies for civilian use. And the countries which are likely to receive such assistance from us are basically of two types. Number one, non-communist countries and non-aligned countries. Now, don't forget the fact that this is the time period of 1951 when the Cold War in the world is going on. So obviously, the communist countries are basically the ideological enemies of the capitalist bloc led by the US. So as a result of which, the US is obviously not going to provide any kind of assistance or support, and that too at the nuclear level, which was one of the monopoly areas of the, you know, players in the Cold War, to specifically communist countries. So under the US Mutual Defense Assistance Act, when the assistance was to be provided, it was basically identified to be provided to the non-communist and non-aligned countries. India, as one of the non-aligned countries, was one of the benefactors of these programs. And when this Assistance Act was launched, India was one of the first countries to apply for assistance under this. And India being a non-aligned country, and in fact one of the leaders of the non-aligned world, India received tremendous amount of support under this domestic legislation of the US. Now, as the time progressed, in the year of 1953, the Americans basically announced what is called as an Atoms for Peace initiative. This initiative was announced by the then American president, Dwight Eisenhower. Dwight Eisenhower basically gave a speech in the United Nations General Assembly. In the speech at that time, he announced a program which is known as the Atoms for Peace Initiative. Now, there are two important words in this particular initiative. One is atoms, that means atomic energy or the nuclear energy. And number two is peace, which means use of atomic energy for peaceful purposes. So, the objective of this program was to give effect to the US Mutual Defense Assistance Act. Now, under this particular program that was launched by the Americans in 1953, what did the US do? The US announced in the UN General Assembly, and this announcement, as I said, was made by the then US President Dwight Eisenhower. Now, what did USA President say at that time? The President said that we are going to provide support and assistance to countries in the world, basically to get access to civilian use of nuclear technology. Now, I have already explained you what civilian use basically means and what two categories come under the civilian category here. So, the US government announced that we are going to provide assistance at the civilian level. This was one of the steps taken by the Americans to counter the Cold War. Now, tomorrow in the prelims, if a question like this comes, that which of the following steps below could amount to an attempt by the Americans to counter the Cold War or counter the Russians, and if one of the points given there is Atoms for Peace Initiative, then such a question should accept the fact that Atoms for Peace Initiative was a Cold War tactic of the Americans. You have to keep that in mind. Now, under the Atoms for Peace Initiative, apart from suggesting that we will provide support at the civilian level, the US also announced that to provide this support, to provide this assistance to the countries in the world, there should be an international organization to be created. So please remember, in 1953, USA proposed the creation of an international organization to facilitate the transfer of these technologies. And this particular organization, which was envisaged under the Atoms for Peace, was finally created in 1957. So in 1957, International Atomic Energy Agency, also known as the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency was born. Please remember again, International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA from now onwards, as I will use, it was basically envisaged under the Atoms for Peace. Now, the IAEA came out with three objectives. Today, IAEA is a very important body in the world. It is an associated organization of the United Nations. And associated organization means that United Nations keeps a control over the functioning of the IAEA, though it is an independent body otherwise. Now, IAEA is number one responsible to overseeing the civilian transfer of technologies. So, as I said, the US Mutual Defense Assistance Act and the Atoms for Peace both wanted to create a framework for sharing of the civilian technologies. That sharing of the civilian technologies was now to be done by the IAEA, number one. Number two, the IAEA as a body was also responsible to set nuclear safety standards. So obviously now, see, this is a very natural point. If the US is going to share with other countries in the world on how to generate nuclear energy, how to enrich uranium for the purpose of, you know, medical use, in that case, certain safety standards have to be followed. So obviously, US as a country does not have the global authority to create safety standards. And US has already announced that an international body should be created to facilitate the transfers. So another additional responsibility of the IAEA was to create these nuclear safety standards. The idea was that these nuclear safety standards would be accepted by all the countries, and nobody would obviously oppose them because they are for the benefit of the country itself. The third important use of the IAEA, or rather the objective of the IAEA, was to prevent the misuse of civilian technology for military use. You know, please remember one thing. Now, as I told you in the webinar number one also, that uranium which is found in nature cannot be used directly. It has to be enriched. The enrichment of uranium is done through a technical process. In that process, we basically mine the uranium from the earth. After we mine the uranium, we crush the uranium rock See, when you mine it from the earth, it is in the form of a rock. So once you mine it, then you crush the uranium in the powder form. Then after that powder is you prepared, there are a lot of chemicals which are added to the powder, and that entire mixture is basically churned. Churned means it is moved in something called centrifuges. The centrifuges basically are technical instruments, which in a very laymanish language, if I try to tell you, they look like test tubes. So there are a lot of centrifuges in which that entire mixture is put, and then that mixture is rotated at a very high speed. Depending upon the speed at which you rotate those centrifuges, you are able to generate the desired percentage of enriched uranium. So if the speed of the, enrichment, or if the speed of the rotation of the centrifuge is slow, you will be able to enrich uranium up to 3 to 5%, which will be used for nuclear energy. But if you start rotating those centrifuges at a very higher speed, relatively higher from the previous case, then you may be in a position to enrich uranium up to 20%. Now, when you enrich uranium up to 20%, as I told you earlier, it is basically medical grade uranium. But now the beauty here is what? The beauty here is, if you have the technology to enrich uranium up to 20% by rotating the centrifuges faster, then you don't need any additional technology, because all you need is to rotate the centrifuges even more faster and achieve enrichment up to 90%. So if you rotate those centrifuges faster at a very, very high speed, you may be in a position to generate uranium enriched up to 90%. So what I am trying to tell you is a very important thing. Please keep that in mind, that if a country is in possession of civilian nuclear technologies, please remember these words very importantly. If a country is in possession of civilian nuclear technologies, then it automatically possesses the capability to enrich uranium for military purpose also. That means there is no fine line to divide the civilian use and military use very clearly. If a country has the capability of enriching uranium for civilian use, it automatically possesses the capability to enrich uranium for military use. Now, coming back to the third point here, the objective of the IAEA in the point number three is to prevent the misuse of civilian technology for military use. How will the IAEA try to do that? The IAEA basically has various kind of agreements, and one of the most important agreements that they have are called safeguard agreements. As per the safeguard agreements, the details related to the safeguard agreements and their functioning are given in the section 9, chapter number 1 of the International Relations Book. Please make sure that you read about those safeguard agreements very carefully to get a complete deep idea. When a country signs those safeguard agreements, the country allows the IAEA inspectors. These IAEA inspectors are not UP police inspectors. They are very technically highly qualified inspectors of the IAEA who happen to go to different countries. And they basically keep a watch by undertaking physical monitoring of the facilities to see whether the country which is using uranium and enriching uranium for civilian use is not trying to misuse it simultaneously for military purpose. So that is one of the very crucial objectives of the IAEA. So in 1957, the IAEA as a body was created. India joined the IAEA as a body. After joining the IAEA as a body, in the year of 1958, India basically prepared its disarmament policy. Now, the disarmament policy of India basically had two components. One of the component was the domestic component of the policy. One of the component was the diplomatic component. Let's first discuss the domestic component. Under the domestic nuclear policy of India, which was announced by India in 1958, India basically said few things. India said we were colonized by the British. The British were responsible for underdevelopment of India. And after independence, the government of India has set a goal to undertake development of India. So India said that if India undertakes development, India would require energy for the purpose of development. In your economics, you must have studied, any standard book, you will understand one thing, that energy is a prerequisite for development. Now, when India said that we want to undertake development, when India said that, energy is required for development, India very importantly explained in 1958 that we are also going to explore all forms of energy for the purpose of development, which would include the nuclear energy also. Why nuclear energy? Because India said that there are two important facts. One, न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी इज एन एनवायरमेंटली फ्रेंडली टेक्नोलॉजी एंड यूजिंग एंड अंडरटेकिंग द यूज ऑफ यू नो न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी फॉर द डेवलपमेंट विल नंबर वन नॉट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू क्रिएटिंग अ बैड एनवायरमेंट एंड वेरी इंपॉर्टेंटली नंबर टू इंडिया सेड दैट द यूज ऑफ न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी विच इज एन एनवायरमेंटल फ्रेंडली टेक्नोलॉजी विच विल नॉट कॉज पोल्यूशन will also become in the future a strategy of India at the developmental level, at the global level, to basically tackle climate change. So you see, India way back in 1958 had this foresight that using of the nuclear technology will give us a leverage in front of the world in the future, where we will be able to tell them that, see, right from the beginning, we have been using the nuclear technologies for the specific purpose that not only it is environmentally friendly and not only we require it for domestic use, but that is also our sense of commitment towards the climate change. So as India explained the domestic policy, India now tried to explain the diplomatic policy also. Now you'll see diplomatically at that time, one thing is very clear, 1958 is the time when the Cold War in the world was going on. So India said at that time that, see, the international situation right now is of the Cold War. And India said that in this Cold War, the USSR and the US are having a rivalry. As I have explained to you earlier, both US and USSR were superpowers. The superpower rivalry was going on. Not only there was a rivalry going on between the superpowers, ironically, in the Cold War, these superpowers were also undertaking an arms race. You see, why do we say that the superpowers were undertaking an arms race? Because if you try to recollect, what is Cold War? Cold War is basically a situation where there is no war, yet there is no peace. If there is no peace, why is there no peace? As I had explained to you, there is no peace because at that time, countries in the world, specifically US and USSR, even though decided that we will militarily not fight, but the urge to fight continued. And as I had explained to you that the urge to fight had continued, how did that urge manifest? One of the ways in which that urge manifested was undertaking an arms race. Now, what is an arms race in a very simple language without going into the technicalities of what the political science optional people study? In a simple language, the arms race basically means racing for procurement of development of arms. So US and USSR, because they perceived each other as enemies, decided to undertake an arms race. They decided to undertake development and procurement of weapons. And not only they decided to undertake development and procurement of weapons, they decided to even develop and procure nuclear weapons. So arms race was not only a normal arms race. This arms race was also having a nuclear component where US and USSR basically tried to fight for development of nuclear weapons. You see, now if US and USSR continue to do arms race, where they develop and procure normal weapons as well as nuclear weapons, such a situation is going to be a threat to the world peace. Why? Because in a simple manner, if a simple logic, you are developing arms. You are developing arms because you are insecure of the other party. You are insecure that the other party might attack you. There is a possibility that the other party may not attack, but there is a serious possibility that the other party may attack. So in order to protect yourself from the attack, you are developing weapons, you are procuring weapons, including nuclear weapons, which is a situation called as a threat to the world peace. So this fear of nuclear arms race was perceived as a threat to the world peace. Now, not only that, let's also understand one thing. US and USSR, as we have explained earlier in the previous webinars, that they both had decided that they will not militarily fight. But you know, the question is, if you are not going to militarily fight, if you have already announced that in the world, and I had explained to you in the webinar number 2, that why US and USSR and in what context they had explained that we will not militarily fight. If you are not going to militarily fight, then why are you developing the weapons? If you are not going to militarily fight, then why are you developing nuclear weapons? So one thing became very clear. They are developing weapons and nuclear weapons because there is an urge to fight. But you have officially announced that we are not going to fight. So one thing becomes very clear, that such a situation was also creating not only a threat to the world peace, but this development and procurement of weapons where you are not going to use them was also perceived as a wastage of public resources. Please, I'm sorry for the spelling error there. But It is basically a wastage of the public resources also. So one thing became very clear. It is in this context that India decided to undertake the announcement of its policy. That is the diplomatic disarmament policy. So what did India say? India said that we are a non-aligned country, and being a non-aligned country, we are already out of the superpower rivalry. And as we are out of the superpower rivalry, we are not going to undertake any kind of armament or arms race. And if we are not going to undertake any kind of armament or arms race, India at that time in this context proposed a two-step policy, which is at the diplomatic level. Number one, India said we want the countries in the world to do disarmament. Try to recollect in the webinar number one, I have explained you already what is the difference between armament, disarmament, and complete disarmament. So India number one said that we want the countries in the world to do disarmament. Disarmament basically in a simple language means reduction of the weapons, including the nuclear weapons. India said that once the countries in the world do disarmament, that is they reduce their weapons, including nuclear weapons, gradually the second step of the strategy is that they should strive for what is called as complete disarmament. Why? Because complete disarmament will basically ensure world peace. So one thing became very clear. Complete disarmament means that you not only reduce your nuclear weapons, but you eventually dismantle your nuclear weapons. So the strategy of complete disarmament is basically a step towards world peace because it envisages a nuclear weapon-free world. So one thing became very clear that India proposed that everything goes in step-by-step manner. You do disarmament, then you go for complete disarmament. Complete disarmament is equal to world peace. So once India announced these strategies, one thing became very clear that India contributed to the world peace. But then there is another state which is the neighbor of India, which is a foolish state, which is called the state of Pakistan. Now, the problem is that Pakistan decided to develop nuclear weapons. The first question is, why did Pakistan decide to develop nuclear weapons? And what was the logic given by Pakistan to develop the nuclear weapons? So let us try to understand that. Now, the first and foremost thing is that Pakistan decided to develop the nuclear weapons after 1971 India-Pakistan war. Try to recollect the information that we have discussed in the webinar number 4, that was the previous webinar. Lot of information is going to be sourced from there. In 1971, when India and Pakistan had a war, at that time one thing became very clear that there was vivisection of the Pakistani territory. Vivisection means division or dismemberment of the Pakistani territory. East Pakistan was gone and Bangladesh was created. So at that time, one thing that Pakistan learnt in 1971 war was that we cannot fight a military war with India because India has conventional military superiority. I have explained the concept of conventional military superiority in the previous webinar. So India the Pakistanis understood that we cannot fight India a conventional war because they have conventional military superiority. So therefore, we need a nuclear weapon. So after 1971, Pakistan decided to procure a nuclear weapon and develop a nuclear weapon. Now, more importantly, Pakistan gave an explanation. Pakistan said that, see, the Americans are Christians, they have a nuclear weapon. Indians are Hindus, they must be developing a nuclear weapon. And if they are not developing, they will one day develop. Israelis are Jews, they have a nuclear weapon. Has a nuclear weapon, then why should we not have a nuclear weapon? And if Pakistan has a nuclear weapon, we can call it as the Muslim nuclear weapon or the Islamic bomb. So Pakistan also gave the Islamic bomb theory. The Islamic bomb theory was based upon this understanding that Pakistan will try to develop a nuclear weapon, which will be a weapon for all the Muslim states in the world. It will be a sign of the prestige of the Muslims. So Pakistan conflated means mixed, their nuclear weapon question with basically the larger Islamic bomb by giving it a religious color. So since the 1970s, you see, the Pakistanis have been behaving like the BJP is behaving today. So they gave a Islamic bomb theory by giving it a religious color. Now, it is also important to remember that Pakistani said that, see, we are not going to fight a conventional war with India because India has conventional military superiority. In the previous webinar, I had explained to you that Pakistan had always, after 1971, and not only after 1971, in fact, in the previous webinar, if you try to recollect, I have already explained you that Pakistan had started the use of irregulars. Those irregulars were basically the jihadi element. And that use of jihadi element to undertake a proxy war is called subconventional war. So conventional wars are wars which are fought between the militaries. And subconventional war is normally a war which is a proxy war, which is one element of subconventional war. So Pakistan had been basically using subconventional elements. In the previous webinar, I had already explained you the concept of master cell, creation of master cell by the ISI. I had explained you Al-Fatah. All those things have to be kept in mind, that they were elements of basically the subconventional war. So Pakistan now said that, you see, once we have the nuclear weapon, that nuclear weapon can also be used as a shield to undertake jihad in Kashmir, where the nuclear weapons will become an umbrella for basically these subconventional warriors. So Pakistan was motivated by multiple factors. One, the most important, as I said, if we quickly recap, was basically post-1971 war, post-vivisection of their territory. They wanted to basically now develop nuclear weapons for their stability, existence, etc. Number two, they believed that because India has conventional military superiority, we cannot fight a conventional war, we have to fight a subconventional war, for which a nuclear weapon can act as a shield. Number three, the subconventional war includes one of the concepts called proxy war. And the proxy war we have explained in the previous webinar, we are not going into that again. So proxy war has to be waged under a nuclear umbrella, because once we have a nuclear weapon, we can use the nuclear weapon as a shield against basically the jihad that we wage in Kashmir. So giving this logic, basically Pakistan began to undertake development of their nuclear weapons. However, it was in 1998 that India decided to undertake their nuclear test. And when India tested their nuclear weapon, it was immediately followed by Pakistan, who also tested their nuclear weapon. So when India and Pakistan tested their nuclear weapon, it led to or created a situation which is known as nuclearization of South Asia. So nuclearization of South Asia was complete by 98, when two ardent hardcore enemies of each other developed nuclear technologies. You see, one of the countries in South Asia, which is called China, had been in possession of the nuclear weapons right from 1964. And in fact, again, I would try to tell you one more thing, that please read the section 9, chapter number 1 of the International Relations book very carefully, because there is a huge element of China factor which is responsible for convincing India to develop the nuclear weapons. So we are not discussing that. Please have a reading of that. Nuclearization of South Asia started with China procuring a weapon. Subsequently, it got complete by 98 when India and Pakistan also tested their weapons. China had tested their weapon way back in 1964. Now, after the Pakistanis tested their nuclear weapon and nuclearization of the subcontinent was complete, one thing happened. Pakistan explained the logic of their nuclear weapons. Pakistan said three things. First thing they said, as I explained you in the previous slide, that there will be use of nuclear weapons as a shield for jihad, which is the point number three given here. Number two, the nuclear weapon and nuclear escalation. Pakistan now said a very important thing. They said, see, we are in possession of nuclear weapons. This possession of nuclear weapons will prevent nuclear escalation. That means, Pakistan said, if we do jihad against India, and this jihad is going to happen under a nuclear umbrella, in that scenario, what will happen is that because India knows that we have nuclear weapons, we will be able to continue to do the jihad under the nuclear weapon and prevent India to respond to us aggressively because we have nuclear weapon. So idea is very clear. Pakistan said prevention of nuclear escalation. That means prevention of an attempt of India to attack us, or prevention of India to retaliate to us, can be done because of the possession of nuclear weapon. And the third thing Pakistan said was that, you know, because we have nuclear weapons and because there could be a nuclear escalation if India tries to retaliate and attack us, there will be an international community intervention. That means Pakistan said, number one, we will do jihad. We will do jihad under a nuclear umbrella, and India will not be able to hit back to us. Why India will not be able to punish us for the jihad? Because we will always have nuclear weapons to show to India that if you punish us, we will use nuclear weapon. And if India tries to punish us, and if India tries to say, no, Pakistan, enough is enough, your jihad has been enough, and I cannot tolerate more jihad. If India tries to punish us, then we may threaten India with nuclear retaliation. And if we threaten India with nuclear retaliation, there will be intervention of the international community. International community will immediately intervene to prevent a nuclear war. So nuclear escalation, intervention of international community has to be seen together with each other. Now, India tested their nuclear weapon in 98. After that, India subsequently announced a nuclear doctrine. In the nuclear doctrine, India number one said that we are not going to use our nuclear weapons against non-nuclear weapon states. That is the first thing. That means that NNWS, non-nuclear weapon states. So India said that those countries in the world which do not have a nuclear weapon are called as non-nuclear weapon states, and we are not going to use our nuclear weapons against them. Number two, India said no first use doctrine. As per the no first use doctrine, India very clearly said that, you see, we are not going to use our nuclear weapons first ever. That means that our weapons have been created for ensuring what is the point number three called credible minimum deterrence. Credible minimum deterrence means three things. There are three words here. Credible means that we have a nuclear weapon, and having a nuclear weapon itself establishes our credibility in the international community to protect us. Number two, minimum deterrence. Minimum deterrence means, again, now please refer the word minimum deterrence with respect to no first use. India says that we have a nuclear weapon. Having a nuclear weapon establishes our credibility in the international community amongst the Committee of Nations to protect us. India number two says that having the weapon is sufficient for us to create the deterrence we require to create. Sir, this is slightly technical. Please be careful to remember this. You can further read about this in the book also, but understand it carefully. India says minimum deterrence. Minimum deterrence means that we will not keep our weapons in the state of readiness all the time, because just possession of the weapon itself is a sufficient condition for us to create the deterrence and deter the other party. India said, I have a nuclear weapon, and I am not going to keep my nuclear weapon in the state of readiness for use every time. Why? Because I have not created my weapon to be used. I have created the weapon only to deter. So basically, it is like if I put it in a very simple language, let's say you live in a crime affected area. And if you live in a crime affected area, how do you protect yourself? One is, obviously, you can lock your door. But obviously, locking your door does not prevent you forever from getting attacked by somebody, or the criminals coming and, you know, looting away your house. But what is another better way of protecting yourself? That you possess a gun. Now, if you possess a gun, for example, what will happen? If a criminal knocks your door or tries to break your door, you can always threaten the criminal with a gun. It's not necessary that if a criminal enters your house, you are going to fire upon the criminal with the gun itself. Merely possession of the gun itself can be a deterrence factor to the criminal, who can just see the gun and run away. That is what precisely India is trying to say here. That we have a nuclear weapon. We are not going to use it in a war. We have not even created it for the purpose of use in the war. That is why no first use. But India says that having the weapon with us is a sufficient condition for us to create the deterrence. That means, having the weapon is a sufficient condition for us to prevent somebody to attack us. That is what India is trying to say. But India said a very important thing. India said that if somebody attacks us, then there will be the point number four, that is massive and unacceptable retaliation on first strike. That means if somebody strikes us first, there will be massive unacceptable. Massive and unacceptable means that the consequences of India's retaliation are going to be unimaginable. That means you may attack us with one nuclear warhead, we may retaliate with 130 nuclear warheads upon you. Massive and unacceptable. Unacceptable here means unimaginable consequences of the retaliation that India will carry out. You see, when India brought about all this, in contrast to it, Pakistan also basically announced few things. When India said we are not going to use the weapon first, Pakistan said we will use the weapon first. So in contrast to no first use of India, Pakistan announced first use of their nuclear weapons. That means Pakistani nuclear posture is escalatory in nature. Why is Pakistani nuclear posture escalatory in nature? Because Pakistan advocates for first use. Number two, when India says credible minimum deterrence, Pakistan says full spectrum deterrence. You know, full spectrum deterrence basically means that India said what? Let us compare and understand. India said, number one, I will not keep my weapons in the state of readiness all the time. Full spectrum deterrence, Pakistan said, number one, I will always keep my weapons in the state of readiness all the time. हमने कहा हम नहीं रखेंगे, उन्होंने कहा हम पक्का रखेंगे. नंबर टू, इंडिया सेड कि भाई हैविंग द वेपन इज सफिशियंट to create the deterrence because I am not going to use it in a war. Full spectrum deterrence means I will always not only keep my weapons in the state of readiness all the time, but if ever required, I will use those weapons in the war also. So full spectrum deterrence was announced by Pakistan. So one thing became very clear that over a period of time, in order to respond to these challenges, the countries India and Pakistan focused on development of their nuclear warheads also. Now, if you see the point number 5, ICBM stands for Intercontinental Ballistic Missiles. India very clearly said, see, we have not created a weapon to be used in a war. We have only created the weapon for the purpose of ensuring deterrence. So India said that the deterrence can be ensured by developing ICBMs. ICBM basically means Intercontinental Ballistic Missile. Intercontinental Ballistic Missile basically means long-range missiles. Pakistan said what? Full spectrum deterrence. What is full spectrum deterrence? That I will keep my weapons in the state of readiness all the time and I will use them in the war. So for that, Pakistan said we will develop tactical nuclear weapons. What are tactical nuclear weapons? Tactical nuclear weapons are those weapons which basically are short-range nuclear weapons. So short-range nuclear weapons can be deployed along the border, and these weapons deployed along the border can be effectively used by Pakistan in the case of war with India. That is what Pakistan said. Keep this point in mind. We'll revisit it again. So now, after basically India and Pakistan became nuclear, there was a Kargil conflict. Now, Kargil conflict happened after nuclearization of South Asia. Now, why did this Kargil conflict happen? Kargil conflict happened because Pakistan wanted to test India's patience. How Pakistan tested India's patience and what was the patience? The patience was basically the nuclear patience. See, after becoming a nuclear weapon state, Pakistan wanted to test that whether India will retaliate to us at a nuclear level or no. So basically, they tried to test that under the Kargil conflict. How did they do that? You know, in 1994, India and Pakistan signed an agreement for the line of control. Please read about the details of this agreement in the India-Pakistan chapter of the book. Under this agreement, both the parties had decided that basically in the month of December, at the northernmost part of the LOC, which is basically in the Kargil Dras sector, both the parties will remove their troops and these troops will reassemble in the northern sector of the LOC in the month of April again. Now, why will we remove our troops? Obviously, because this area of the northern sector of the LOC, which is the Kargil Dras sector, comes under the influence of very heavy snow. So to ensure that there is protection of the, you know, military assets and also the protection of the military manpower deployed there, both the parties decided that we will mutually withdraw our troops, but we will redeploy the troops. We will withdraw the troops in December and redeploy the troops again in the month of April. Now, in the year of 1998, after nuclearization, see, both the parties became nuclear in the month of May and June. India tested their weapons in May and Pakistan tested their weapons in June 1998. In the month of December 1998, Pakistan violated this agreement. India removed their troops in December from the Kargil Dras sector, which had to be redeployed in 1999 April. But Pakistan did not do that. So Pakistan not only did not withdraw their troops, but after not withdrawing their troops, they brought an infantry division of their army, which was called the NLI, that is the Northern Light Infantry. So Pakistan brought Northern Light Infantry. Mix the Northern Light Infantry with basically Lashkar-e-Taiba irregulars, and these Lashkar irregulars plus the members of the Northern Light Infantry of Pakistani Army continued to not only hold the peaks and hold the mountains which they were having on their side, but ironically, in the December month when India withdrew because of the harsh climate there, Pakistanis tried to also cross over onto the Indian side of the LOC and tried to occupy peaks of the Indian side as well. Now what happened? In 1999 April, when India went back to reoccupy the peaks on the Indian side, they were very surprised because at that time we discovered that these Pakistanis have not only crossed over the LOC, but we discovered that they have also crossed over and occupied the peaks on our side of the LOC. So at that time, India basically, number one, in the month of April, very clearly told Pakistan that, see, this will not be tolerable. This is a violation of a bilateral agreement and you have to basically withdraw and go back. Pakistan refused. When Pakistan refused to go back and decided that, you know, we will not go back because we want to provoke you. So one thing became very clear. Pakistan stayed. Now, when Pakistan stayed, India decided that fine, LOC is sacrosanct We have to hold the sanctity of the LOC. We have to push them back across their part of the LOC. So we at that time in India launched an airstrike followed by military operation on the ground. So India basically used the army and the air force together. And after using the army and the air force, we removed these Northern Light Infantry and Lashkar people from the Indian side of the LOC and pushed them on the Pakistan side of the LOC. Now, one thing became very clear that when we carried out this military operation, at that time, Pakistan did not retaliate to us with the nuclear weapon. Obviously, they had no such concept of using the nuclear weapon because, the fault was of the Pakistanis only. Now, when Pakistanis did not retaliate with the nuclear weapon, this nuclear shield myth basically got broken. Because one thing India understood at that time is that the nuclear bluff of Pakistan is basically called. The nuclear bluff of Pakistan was, again, I'm sorry for the spelling error there. The nuclear bluff of Pakistan that was called was basically that Pakistan did not use the nuclear weapon even at a time when India was able to retaliate to them for basically their adventurism in Kargil. So one thing India understood is that there is always a space to retaliate. And this space has to be basically at the subconventional level only. That means that India said that if Pakistanis cross over into our territory and if they breach the LOC, then we can use our entire force at that time to basically remove them and retaliate back to them. So Pakistani nuclear bluff was called, nothing happened. So once Pakistani nuclear bluff failed and they miserably also got defeated in the Kargil conflict, Pakistan tried to take a revenge. The revenge happened in the December of 1999 itself, when IC-814 was hijacked by the ISI of Pakistan in consultation with Al Qaeda. And after that, it was taken as an aircraft all the way to Kandahar in Afghanistan. And we have talked about why Taliban was not involved in the IC-814 hijacking in the webinar number 3 only. We don't need to go into those points. But we know one thing, that after the IC-814 hijacking happened, basically at that time, one thing became very clear, that in order to get the aircraft released, India basically had to, in a bilateral swap agreement, release Masood Azhar, one of the terrorists held by India. Masood Azhar was basically a terrorist of Harkatul Ansar group who had basically come to India in the year of 1994 on a fake Portuguese passport. And he was basically here in India and was basically traveling in Kashmir with the objective of, unifying the Harkatul Ansar terrorist group for the purpose of jihad in Kashmir. That was the time when he was basically arrested by the Indian security forces. And in 1999, when IC-814 hijacking happened, Masood Azhar was released. When he went back in the year 2000, he created a terrorist group which is called Jaish-e-Mohammed. Masood Azhar is a Deobandi. And Deobandi terrorist means that he was associated with basically these Deobandi terrorist groups of Afghanistan and also the Deobandi terrorist groups in Pakistan. So ISI gave him a lot of liberty and enabled him to create a new group at that time, which was called Jaish-e-Mohammed. So please remember, even though Masood Azhar was part of Harkatul Ansar, but now, after his release, ISI preferred that he does not remain a part of, Harkatul Ansar anymore, but also goes for creation of his own group as a reward for it. So he created Jaish-e-Mohammed. Now, what happened? Jaish-e-Mohammed in the year 2001 attacked the Indian Parliament. When he attacked the Indian Parliament in 2002, India basically decided to respond by launching Operation Parakram. What is Operation Parakram? Under the Operation Parakram, India decided that we will mobilize our troops and basically take those troops at the Pakistan border. And the Pakistan border that stretches all the way from Rajasthan till basically the LOC in the Kashmir. So idea of India was that under Operation Parakram, we will do military mobilization in 1 week. That means that we will mobilize our military units from all over the country, and within 1 week, we basically will take them to the Pakistan boundary. Now, the problem was that even though Operation Parakram was planned, and even though we wanted to mobilize the military and take it to the Pakistan border in 1 week, when the Operation Parakram was executed, it took us 5 weeks. Why? Because, the military mobilization was very slow. We were not able to calculate it well. That will we be able to actually do it in 1 week or not? We just announced it, and when it actually happened, it took us 5 weeks. After 5 weeks, when we reached there, that surprise element that we wanted to give to Pakistan was basically over. Because in 5 weeks, when we reached there, we were ourselves surprised to see Pakistani troops already pointing their guns at us. So, the Operation Parakram miserably failed. Now, after the failure of Operation Parakram, India realized that something has to be done. Pakistani adventurism has to stop. So it is in this backdrop that in the year of sometime around 2003 and 4, India announced Cold Start Doctrine. Under the Cold Start Doctrine, it was a response by India after the failure of Operation Parakram. Now let us try to understand Cold Start Doctrine by all these questions which are there in the slide itself. Number one, what is Cold Start? It is a military doctrine. It is a military doctrine of India, which India intends to use against Pakistan. Now, number two, when will it be used? It will be used whenever Pakistan undertakes any kind of adventurism. Now, what constitutes adventurism for Cold Start to be executed is to be decided by the political executive, not by the army. Please remember, army will be using the Cold Start. Army will be implementing the Cold Start. But army does not have the power to implement it suo motu. That means on its own. So what constitutes political adventurism has to be defined by the political executive. Ironically, Cold Start came in 2003-04. After that, in 2006 also there were Mumbai attacks. 2008 there were Mumbai attacks. Post that, there have been many attacks in, you know, different parts of India as well as in Kashmir. But somehow the political executive does not feel that they require a response by India through Cold Start. So political executive to define the adventurism. Number three, how will Cold Start hit Pakistan? So you see, what India is going to do under the Cold Start doctrine is that it is going to create integrated battle groups. Integrated battle groups are basically a mixture of infantry, artillery and armor. So these three units, infantry, artillery and armor of the army, are going to be fused together to create an integrated battle group, IGB. This integrated battle group will be used in the Cold Start. Now, what will happen in the Cold Start is that whenever the political executive gives the clearance that fine, there has been political adventurism by Pakistan and we need to hit them by Cold Start, this integrated battle group of the Indian Army, they will cross over the international border with Pakistan. And after crossing over the international border, they will make a shallow penetration in the Pakistani territory. Shallow penetration means that they will occupy small parts of the Pakistani territory along the border. And once they, you know, occupy small parts of the Pakistani territory along the border, what will happen is that this part of the territory, which Indian army will quickly and swiftly capture, these integrated battle groups will swiftly capture, will then be used by India as a bargaining chip to bargain with Pakistan to dismantle their terrorist architecture. So idea of the Cold Start is very clear, sir. If Pakistan resorts to adventurism, integrated battle groups which are posted close to the border will immediately cross over the border. They will undertake a shallow penetration and they will undertake a shallow penetration and occupy and capture the territory of Pakistan. Such captured territory will basically be used by India as a bargaining chip with Pakistan to dismantle their terrorist architecture. Now, one important thing is, if you try to recollect some time back, I told you that Pakistan had explained one thing in 1998, that if India tries to retaliate to us for anything, we will try to undertake escalation by basically threatening them with nuclear weapon. And if a nuclear weapon threat is given to India by Pakistan, Pakistan said that it will lead to intervention of the international community also, and the international community will come and try to resolve the conflict. That international community could be UN, it could be US, it could be France, it could be anybody. That's a futuristic scenario. We do not know what constitutes that. That's only an imagination in the Pakistani mind. But the idea is that the Cold Start is likely to nullify the intervention of this international community. Why will the Cold Start nullify this international intervention is because the operation under the Cold Start will be so swift, so fast, that before the international community even thinks of doing something, India would have done the damage to Pakistan by occupying their territory. You know, in the Operation Parakram, as I just told you, that Operation Parakram was to be launched in 1 week, but in reality took 5 weeks. Now, if the Operation Parakram had to be done in 1 week, 1 week is more than sufficient time for the international community to do mobilization and do some response. So idea is to prevent them to do that. So idea under the Cold Start is that this operation, once executed, within 48 hours, within 48 hours, Indian army will cross over, capture the territory, hold the territory and use it as a bargaining chip. So the intervention of the international community automatically gets nullified, because by the time the international community intervenes, India would be holding a significant amount of chunks of Pakistani territory. Now, how has Pakistan responded to this? Pakistan responded to this by saying that fine, we will develop tactical nuclear weapons. Tactical nuclear weapons, I told you, are short-range nuclear weapons. Pakistan said we will develop tactical nuclear weapons and deploy them at the border with India. That if Indian army crosses over under Cold Start, and if Indian army under Cold Start tries to basically capture our territory, then we will use tactical nuclear weapons against India at that time and target Indian cities through nuclear retaliation. How did India respond to this? India said, fine, Pakistan, if you ever use a nuclear weapon against us, we have already explained that there will be massive and unacceptable retaliation in the case of first strike. So one thing is very clear, sir. The entire game plan is clear. Under Cold Start, India is using integrated battle groups. India is not using nuclear weapons. India has already said no first use. But India will carry out a massive military operation. India will carry out a military operation of capturing their territory. Pakistan says, you capture my territory, I will use nuclear weapon. India says, you use nuclear weapon, I will use massive and unacceptable retaliation. So Cold Start doctrine also to some extent is basically a strong response of India to nuclear escalation of Pakistan. So one thing is very clear, that though Cold Start has been there in the news, it has never been used by India. Under what circumstance will it be used is going to be decided by the political executive. So Cold Start remains a strategy. But under what case are we going to use? That is remaining something debatable. Now, keeping that in mind, if we move further, then the question that arises here is that what is India's disarmament policy after 98? You see, India earlier said one thing. What did India say earlier? India said ki bhai, we want disarmament, we want complete disarmament. You know, we want all the countries in the world to destroy their nuclear weapons. But then if India basically stood for that, the question that arises is that why did India itself become a nuclear weapon state and acquire weapons in 98? We have seen and we know one thing. India acquired nuclear weapons because Pakistanis were driven to develop their nuclear weapons in 1971 and after 1971. China already had a weapon. So because of the strategic scenario around us, where Pakistan was on the verge of developing a weapon, China already had a weapon, it was that basically security of India which was under a threat. Our existence was under a threat that compelled India to develop a weapon in 98. Further details are given in the International Relations Book, Section 9, Chapter Number 1. Please read them. Once India said that, fine, we will develop a nuclear weapon, one thing became very clear, that it impacted our disarmament policy. Now, what did India say after 98? India came out with a theory called proportionate disarmament. Under the proportionate disarmament, one thing India said very clearly is that, see, we have a nuclear weapon. But we are one of the only countries in the world which till today says that we still stand for complete disarmament. But we say that complete disarmament will be done only if all the countries in the world do complete disarmament. You see, today India may be having nuclear weapons, and India may not have any standing to talk about complete disarmament. But India still remains committed to complete disarmament. This means that India says that even though we have nuclear weapons with us, but we still want countries in the world to destroy their nuclear weapons. We still want countries in the world to destroy their nuclear weapons and create a nuclear weapon-free world. And India says that if all countries in the world destroy their nuclear weapons, India will also destroy its nuclear weapons. See, this posture is something which is very unique in the international community because no country in the world says this except us. We are the only country in the world which says that we are willing to relinquish and destroy our nuclear weapons, provided all countries in the world destroy their nuclear weapons first. Because India says, even if one country in the world possesses nuclear weapons, it's a threat to us. And if one country in the world, any one country, it can be US, it can be France, it can be Britain, it can be Russia, it can be Pakistan, it can be North Korea, it can be Iran, it can be anybody. India says if any one country in the world also possesses nuclear weapons, India has a right to possess nuclear weapons. But if all the countries in the world destroy their nuclear weapons, India will also destroy its nuclear weapons. So post 1998, India has basically stated very clearly, our disarmament is proportionate to the disarmament done by the world. So one thing is very clear, our disarmament is proportionate to the disarmament done by the world. Proportionate means if everybody disarms, we will disarm. If any one country has weapon, we will also have weapon. And obviously, as far as escalation matrix is concerned, India's response to escalation matrix of Pakistan is the cold start. So therefore, these are the things that you need to keep in mind, which remain as challenges to the global nuclear proliferation order today. So now let us have a look at certain questions. And now please let me know if you have any questions so we can answer those questions and then we can end the webinar. So you see, there is a question that do we need to review our no first use policy as indicated by Rajnath Singh. See, Rajnath Singh is a foolish fellow. These kind of statements that keep on coming need not to be taken seriously, because these kind of statements are only statements and are not policy directions. So we don't need to revisit our no first use doctrine. But yes, theoretically arguing, if there is a need to revisit it, then there are various conditions under which it can be revisited. So you can read the section one of the section 9 of the chapter 1 of the book. There are 9 conditions I have explained there that under what condition should we revisit our nuclear doctrine if required. But we don't need to pay attention to these statements made by the political leaders, because these statements do not indicate any policy. So there is another question: how have US and China and Russia responded? Nobody has given an official response to India's cold start. So there is no response. Okay, there is a question: please explain integrated battle group. Now, integrated battle group basically is a fusion of artillery, armor, and infantry. Artillery, armor, and infantry are units of the armed forces. A fusion of these three constitutes an integrated battle group. So in an integrated battle group, we will have members of infantry, we will have members of artillery, we will have members of armor. Together, they will undertake an operation to carry out the cold start. Okay, so there is another question: how is disarmament ensured that it is done? See, as of now, nobody has done disarmament. And obviously, if any disarmament ever occurs, there will be an inspection by the IAEA for that. That is obvious. Even though countries may verbally say that, you know, we want to do disarmament, but nobody has till now ever done disarmament. There is a question: IGB has what parts of the army? I have explained: infantry, artillery, armor. Please read, you know, it's given in the India-Pakistan chapter in the IR book also. What is the present status of India's short-range nuclear weapons? India is developing short-range nuclear weapons, but we have not officially announced that. We don't need to talk about it. Okay, there is a question that can you explain credible minimum deterrence again? I'll do that. Three words are there: credible. Credible means that I have a weapon. Having a weapon itself is a sufficient condition to create that credibility that I can defend myself. Minimum deterrence means I don't need to keep my weapon in the state of readiness all the time. Why? Because I have not created the weapon to be used in a war. Having the weapon is a sufficient deterrence upon those countries who may want to attack me. So that is basically credible minimum deterrence here. So there is a question: ki can international community pressurize India after capturing small parts in Pakistan under cold start? See, obviously, international community can pressurize. They always have the liberty to do that. But then the question is, international community cannot force us to leave those areas. Pressurization is different from compelling us to do something. You know, they can pressurize. They can make statements that India should not do this, India should remove those, you know, areas which are held under their control, etc. But they cannot compel us, because once we have captured those territories under cold start, those territories are going to be used as a bargaining chip with Pakistan, as I have explained. So there is a question: who has the final say for deploying the nuclear weapons in India? It is the civilian political leadership, not the military leadership. In case of Pakistan, it is military. In case of India, it is the civilian political leadership. So there is a question: is surgical strike a part of cold start? Answer is no. They are two very different things. Don't confuse the two. Credible, there is a question that please explain the word credible in credible minimum deterrence. I think I have clarified it again and I'll repeat it once more. Credible means that I have a weapon, and having the weapon itself gives me the credibility to defend myself. So credibility comes with the possession of the weaponry, that you have to remember. So I think most of the other questions are repetitive in nature, and I think I have been able to answer almost most of the questions which are there. So fine, the webinar series comes to an end today. And as I explained in the beginning also, that I will be available on Telegram, where we will continue to keep posting questions and answers, etc. And on top of that, I will be available on the email. Please continue to read the International Relations book. And while you are reading, if you have any difficulties, please feel free to email me for those doubts. And also at the same time, there will be additional material which I have been providing for the last 2 months on the McGraw Hill Education Student Portal. So if you have the third edition of the book, you can access that additional study material. And on the McGraw Hill Student Portal, from the month of January, as I had explained you, we shall also be having videos which we will be uploading on the McGraw Hill Student Portal exclusively for the readers of the third edition of the book only. So I hope you have enjoyed these webinar series, and I hope that these webinar series were able to give you the adequate clarity on how to approach the subject. Now, in the same way, please read the rest of the chapters of the book. The third edition of the book has been relatively very less in the number of pages, and the entire book has to be read from the general studies perspective. So any GS aspirant preparing for 2021 exam has to read the entire book cover to cover, all the chapters. In case you have any doubts, please free to email me. My email address is already given in the book in the first page itself. Thank you so much.